Welcome to the Abyss. I'm Jacqueline, and today we are discussing deep ocean circulation, the final part in our ocean circulation series. Let's dive in. The last component of ocean circulation is the circulation that occurs in the deep ocean. On average, the ocean is 4,000 meters deep, whereas the wind only affects to about 1,000 meters. This means that the currents of the deep ocean are density-driven instead of driven by the wind. This circulation is referred to as the thermohaline circulation. Thermo comes from the Greek word for heat, and haline refers to salt. Therefore, the circulation in the deep ocean is caused by the varying temperatures and salinities of the water and how these two properties affect its density. Similar to air masses, which have temperature and humidity signatures, water masses have temperature and salinity signatures. This means that temperature and salinity can be used to identify and to follow water masses as they circulate. The density of water masses can also be used to determine what will happen when two water masses meet. For example, when a denser water mass encounters a less dense one, it will sink and move beneath it. The effect of temperature on the density and movement of water can be demonstrated by water in a tank. We start by placing ice cubes in the water and adding a few drops of food coloring so we can see the water's movement. The ice cools the surrounding water, and the water becomes denser, causing it to sink. Once it has sunk to the bottom, it spreads outwards. We can also demonstrate the effect that salinity has on the density of water. We're going to start by pouring salt into water, mixing it up and adding a few drops of food coloring. This creates a water mass that has a high salinity compared to the water in our tank. When we pour this water into the tank, since it has a high salinity, it has a higher density. Therefore, the water sinks to the bottom and then spreads out. In the Atlantic, salty surface water cools in the Arctic and sinks. This forms a deep water mass called the North Atlantic Deep Water. A similar water mass forms in the Antarctic and is called the Antarctic Bottom Water. This mass gets its name because it is the densest of the water masses and consequently moves along the bottom of the ocean. Therefore, when the North Atlantic Deep Water encounters the Antarctic Bottom Water, it moves over the top of the bottom water since it is less dense. Similar deep water masses to the ones found in the Atlantic are not found in the North Pacific. This is because the water at higher latitudes is too shallow and not saline enough for deep water masses to form. One water mass that has a unique temperature and salinity signature is the Mediterranean Sea mass. Since the Mediterranean Sea receives so little precipitation and has such a high rate of evaporation, the water mass that forms there has a high temperature and a high salinity. Eventually, this water mass becomes dense enough that it sinks and flows into the Atlantic Ocean. Although the Mediterranean Sea mass is much warmer than the surrounding Atlantic water, it stays relatively deep because it has a much higher salinity. The movement of these water masses forms an ocean-wide circulation pattern referred to as the Great Ocean Conveyor Belt. The ocean conveyor belt starts with water being cooled off the coast of Iceland due to cold air from the Arctic. This water then sinks to the bottom of the ocean and flows south, forming the North Atlantic Deep Water. This water has a high salinity but a low amount of dissolved nutrients. The water then moves south towards Antarctica, where it meets and moves over top of the Antarctic Bottom Water. These two water masses then move farther south, where they join a fast-moving eastward current around the edge of Antarctica. This current efficiently mixes the North Atlantic deep water with the other water masses. From this current that moves east around Antarctica, two sections break off. One moves into the Indian Ocean and the other into the North Pacific. As these sections move north, the water warms and rises, eventually upwelling. This upwelling brings dissolved nutrients from the bottom of the ocean into the surface waters. This makes these areas of the ocean very nutrient-rich. The warm surface waters then circulate back around the globe, eventually returning to the North Atlantic, where the conveyor belt begins. Unlike the surface ocean currents, the deep ocean currents move incredibly slowly. It can take these water masses decades to centuries to move across a single ocean basin. The ocean conveyor belt describes the general pattern of the circulation, but this does not mean an individual water molecule will follow its exact path. However, studying the circulation of the deep ocean is incredibly important. That's because it has a huge impact on our climate and the deep water transport of dissolved nutrients. So that is how the thermohaline circulation and the deep ocean currents work. That concludes our series on ocean circulation. If you liked this series and would like to see a series on another topic, let us know in the comments down below. Thanks for watching, and until next time, I will see you later.